Yes, indeed, there are a lot of talented people in our community. One such is Sudarshan Narayana. He is a film producer, and in fact, we did talk to Sudarshan on previous occasions on our show. Let me welcome Sudarshan once again to our show. Sudarshan, thanks very much for finding time.
Thanks for having me, Nataraj. Thank you.
Of course, we did have a chat a long time back. I know that when
you were when we did the Oasis film.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
right.
And we did have.
You can tell us how this whole thing started in your life, because I know that you have been very passionate about the stage, and then you came onto the movie. How this all happened?
Yes, well, it really did start quite young for me, because one of my uncles, he's a cinematographer, who was very much instrumental in kind of supporting and building the alternate cinema in my language, Kannada.
Right.
So he was primarily influential on me to be interested in film and consequently theater and everything else.
Right.
So when I was very young, I made a short film on 8mm. And this was back in India in 1979.
Right, right. Yeah, those days. Yeah.
Those days. And yeah. And there was a festival in India which was very unique. It didn't happen after since that, mm-hmm. since the initial festival. So I made a short film for that. It was only 4.5 minutes long.
Mm-hmm.
But then I got into theater with Prema Karanth, who is one of the
yes.
stalwarts of kids theater in Kannada.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of people who have come through her and who have made big names now in Kannada film
right.
and theater. So I was into theater through her Alibaba and 40 Thieves. And then I kind of graduated into Banaka, which is a amateur theater with professional productions,
right?
Which was basically started by B.B. Karan. So we were actually producing his plays. So acting in those plays and being part of the whole production, it gave me a very good insight into how a theater works, and not just what happens on stage, but what happens in the background, how you pop put together, what happens before for the 30 days before you go on to stage and all that. So it was quite a educative process.
Mm.
So I was involved in theater in the 80s in India. And then I started writing my small plays myself and producing them and all that. So once I migrated to Australia in 1992, pretty much the theater kind of stopped. In the sense, actual production stopped. I couldn't be part of any production here. But I was still reading and writing and all that. So in Sydney, we actually have produced 3 plays in my language.
Yep.
So since 1999, we have been producing plays. And also, you might know that when the digital technology came along, so I could get back into making films again.
Yes, yeah.
Before then, it was film, it was expensive, there was no way you could do that. So once I could actually edit it on my PC at home, it became much easier.
Yeah,
so that's when I made my first short film in Australia called Clouds Weep on the Greenness,
right, right.
Which was the top 16 in Tropfest that year.
Yes, that's right. That's when we had a chat, I think.
Yes, we also
at that time,
spoke.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was a big boost for me that there was a recognition, and I thought, okay, this is something I can do, and this is something which I can pursue.
Well, the thing is that. When you migrated to Australia, how did you find the theatre and the filmmaking and other as compared to India? What's the difference, you think?
Well, there are two aspects to it, I think. Mm. One is the social aspect.
Yeah.
Because when you are so much active in one country and you move into another country, the whole parameters, the whole factors working in theatre or film is entirely different.
Mm.
And you can't expect them to be same, obviously, because of different countries, different political situations, different histories and all that kind of thing. So culturally, I found it very, very different. Now, it took me a while to understand what is happening, because I thought theatre is like that everywhere in the world before migrating. But when I came here, it was like... To start with, it was much more professional here, and there you could walk up to a rehearsal hall and meet people and then start engaging with them.
Yeah.
But it was not like that. I mean, there was no possibilities of that happening. I still remember the first time when I came here, there was a poetry reading competition in the University of New South Wales library.
Right.
And I went there, and actually I've never written an English poem, but because I wanted to be part of it, I actually wrote an English poem and went there and read it.
Right.
So this was kind of my kind of efforts to see where I can fit in and what I can do and all that kind of thing. So yeah, I think there's a huge difference. It is cultural difference. Mm-hmm. I mean, cultural difference. I'm not complaining about it. I'm just saying it's something there.
Mm.
And it took a while for me to understand that there is this huge difference and how I'm going to fit into this. Australia is basically, when it comes to the theater, I was involved in India. It was much more open, in the sense we could use open spaces easily, because I was involved in street theater in India.
Yes.
So use of public space was so easy in India. Probably not that easy now, but it used to be very easy there. Here it was almost impossible.
Mm.
I mean,
you had to go to the council.
Even if you want to busk, you need to get a license.
That's
so
right. Yeah.
All those kind of things, I was kind of taken aback. And the only thing I can say is it took me a long time to come to terms with those kind of changes and differences in Australia.
Right, but you do something else for your bread and butter, I'm sure.
Yes.
You are an IT person, information technology. How do you balance it? You'll have to obviously find work and then also find time to pursue your passion.
Because it's not alien to me. I've always been doing this.
Okay.
Well, since I got my first job in Myco, which is a factory in India, I was involved in theater before then.
Right.
So it was a common thing to work up to 5 and then rush at 6 o'clock to theater and be involved until 10 o'clock and get back home, sleep, and your mother is saying, "Oh, what are you doing? You know, your life's so, you're not looking after yourself, la 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 la." And then next day, early morning, 6 o'clock, go to work, 5 o'clock, rush to theater.
Right.
So it's been a part of life, and I can't see anything else, any other way of doing it.
Right.
I mean, sometimes I think I'll probably I am more productive when I'm actually doing it as a part time rather than a full time.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Until you actually switch to the full time mode.
Yes.
You know, it's probably better if you're doing a part time work and then this becomes your other source of nourishment for intellectual nourishment or emotional nourishment was the part. Yeah.
Hmm.
So it's always been common to me to do that, and So even in Australia, I've been working in IT, as you said, for a long time, but I was constantly reading and writing plays and short film scripts and film scripts and all that kind of thing. And I attended Metro Screens courses to see, to learn how you direct people. All this has been done part-time, part-time as in not earning part-time, but just allocating your time as a part of your day. Yeah.
Of course, you had to obviously go back to Bangalore in India to produce Mukhamukhi for your first feature film. Then you will have to actually take leave from your work and then come back and get back into workforce again.
Yes, I mean, one good thing is I was, since 1999, I've been consulting. So since I'm contracting, always say, okay, I'm not going to work for next 6 months. Finish off, go away, and then come back and look for another contract.
Right.
Which is what I've been doing, and it's worked for me. I'm not saying it was worked perfectly, but it did work.
Mm.
And then I couldn't find work for some time, and then I could get it back into work and all that kind of thing. So, it is possible if you really want to do that.
Yeah.
And it is.
They say once you have a passion for something, you always find time.
You'll find ways of doing things.
Yeah. If we come to Mukhamukhi, what's it about? What's that film about?
Mukhamukhi, which I shot in 2005-06.
Yes.
It is based on a English play by J.B. Presley called As an Inspector Calls.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually set in 1912, written in 1940s. When I read that play, I thought, this situation is so much familiar. I am familiar with this situation in India now, in 2005 or whatever. And I thought, I think there's a lot of this, not just this setup, but the characters, the way the characters think, the way the characters perceive the world. I could see so many parallels in the Indian society today.
Mm.
And I thought, this suits so well. Well, I couldn't just transport the whole play into a film, it won't work. So I had to do a lot of work in trying to get that two things: one, to make it contemporary to India, and then also make it work as a film.
Mm. Well, how was it taken by the audience, especially in Karnataka, in India?
No, it was really taken really well. I mean,
right.
Because once people can see the characters they recognize,
mm-hmm.
and they can identify with,
yes.
and the situations they can recognize and they can identify, they love it. So it was actually taken really well in Karnataka.
But nowadays, if you see the commercial movies with all the songs and dances thrown in,
mm-hmm.
but yours is more art film.
Yeah.
How does that, how are the audience in India now taking this more and more?
I think so. I think Indian audience are maturing in a way that they can recognize now that there can be a story told powerfully without song and dance and all the other bells and whistles. Now, because even in, you know, like in Bollywood, you know, typical Hindi cinema, also there is a stream of people who are doing films like this, mm-hmm. and getting noticed and all that kind of thing. But it's, I mean, the thing is, when it comes to Indian cinema, people realize that it's happening only when it happens in Bollywood.
Yes.
But regional films like Kannada, Malayalam, Bengali, even Telugu, Tamil, we have been doing these kind of films for the last 50 years.
Mm.
As against all the big name Bollywood and all that, so there's always been this alternate cinema stream which was very strong. But now that Hindi films also are making, people notice, oh yeah, yeah, this new kind of films, and they started recognizing that and all that kind of thing. But it's been there. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, albeit the audience are small, which is not just because the films are bad, but it's also because the distribution model is geared up towards stardom and stars and big cutouts and all that kind of thing. I mean, it's. I think the audience are growing now, and also the technology is helping, because you can do an online release, and
yes,
then people can just watch it wherever they are. But that was never the case. So I think two things. One is the technology aiding for all kinds of people to make films, of the kind of films they like to do, not just be fit into this formula. They can do whatever they want, and that's technology enabling us to do that. And then the audience, because there's all these films coming in, I think the audience are also maturing, and they're recognizing different formats, different styles, and so I think we are moving in that direction. Not as fast as I would like to, but it's happening.
Yeah, I was going to ask you the same question, actually. Now the way in which people are watching movies, films are changing. For example, I don't go to theaters as often as I used to. And nowadays, people want to watch movies sitting in a train on their tablet or laptop or something, or on YouTube. How does this change in the way in which people are seeing the movies affect the production of those movies? Like, for example, your movies.
Yeah, I mean, there are, like, the production as in the technical side, I think it is much more easier now. Like, you can have you don't even have to go to Switzerland to shoot something.
That's
now.
Right,
you can
course.
Do it wherever you want.
Of course.
So that's, technology is really good that way, so you can do it. But there's one aspect about commodifying the cinema media into tablets and mobile phones and all that. The one thing which is missing is, when you have 100 people sitting together and watching a film, you feed off each other. And that aspect is being lost.
Right.
Now, even the screening I had today, at a certain point in my film, as soon as somebody recognizes something is happening, they give out a sigh. Or they go, oh. Then it affects all these other people sitting. So it's a community activity where you all sit together and watch.
Yeah.
That is missing.
Mm.
See, this affects the creative process as well,
yes.
because you wouldn't want to do things which a group of people would watch anymore, because you will probably gear towards somebody putting in an earphone and just watching it by themselves.
Yes.
So obviously that's going to change the style or the narrative style of how you're telling the story.
I think it's similar to somebody watching the cricket match in SCG as against sitting there
on
and watching TV. On a TV.
TV.
Absolutely. So different experiences
altogether.
Yeah.
So you lose some and you gain some, because if you're sitting in SCG, you wouldn't be able to watch the replays, you wouldn't be able to watch the stichometer and all that kind of thing.
Of course.
But if you are, you know, if you are in front of TV, you get all that.
Mm.
But then you lose out on all the atmosphere,
yeah,
how people,
well,
you know, how they are reacting.
That's
you
right.
can scream out to the player on the, you know, on the boundary line and all that kind of thing.
Yes.
So I think creatively also, I think it makes a difference. And you know now that because of the TV, you got short forms of games of 2020s, which, you know, if you have 1.5 hour game and you have to travel, say, 1 hour to get there, you watch for 2 hours and get back 1 hour. But that wasn't the case before. You walk,
yeah.
go there in the morning and come back home in the evening again.
That is true.
So all these things happen.
Yeah.
So I think
the cultural shift.
Shifts, yeah.
yeah.
And technology also has a part in
it. Has, of course, a part in it.